Hello, children of Florida. Is your father, if you're somehow uncomfortable with the word father, you can always refer to me as the top T. Top G is already taken, and as we've discussed before, there is no such thing in the history of the world in the past or going forward as a top B. Unless, of course, you are a breeder of dogs. Now, today we're going to discuss how to recover from mistakes. But first, I need something to drink, cold to drink. Water, my favorite. This is a cobalt blue glass bottle. This is my daily water bottle. Thought you should know. All right, I suppose I should give you the weather. You're going to get the one sentence weather report. Here goes. I'm in Colorado. It's nearly spring. So today, children, I'm going to teach you how to recover from mistakes. Now, there are two flavors of mistakes. There's great big ones and there's little tiny ones. Obviously, little tiny ones can add up to great big ones. And so now I'm going to read from the Bible. So come along and Bible with me. So we're going to read something called the parable of the prodigal son. Now, if Bible's not your thing, this is a parable of Jesus written in Luke. Before I've told you, Luke is written by a guy named Luke. And also Luke wrote a book called Acts. If you go to cemetery school, other people call it seminary, they will refer to this as Luke Acts. But Luke wrote Luke. And Luke wrote the parable of the prodigal son, quoting Jesus. If you have a problem with Jesus, just pretend Neil deGrasse Tyson said it. Parable of the prodigal son, here it is, and I will extrapolate and extract some lessons for you on how to recover from life mistakes. There was a man who had two sons. The younger son said to his father, "Father, give me a share of the property that's coming to me." And so the dad divided the property between them. Not many days later, the son was hasty. The younger son gathered all he had and took a journey into a far country. And there he squandered, i.e. wasted, his property in reckless living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine came out to the land, and he began to be in need. So he spent all his money on booze and whores and silly things, and now he's out of money, and now they're in a recession, or something bad is happening in the land, and he's running out of money. And so he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of the country, who sent him into his fields to feed pigs. Jews at this point in time, pigs were considered unclean animals. He was a Jewish boy, but yet he had to basically do the worst job on the planet. And so he was feeding pigs, and he was longing to be fed. He was hungry with the pods that the pigs ate, and no one gave him anything. So he made a big mistake, and the big mistake was he took his inheritance and he ran off and spent it on wild women and fancy food and just, you know, fun times. And then he ran out. But when he came to himself, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread, but I perish here with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants.' And so he arose and went to go to his dad's house. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said, 'Father,'" said what he planned to say, "'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.'" Accurate statement. "But father said to his servant, 'Bring quickly the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet.'" The robe symbolized honor. He was honoring the son. The ring symbolized authority. So he was putting a signet ring on the son's hand to say, you are restored, you have authority. So that's the robe and that's the ring. And then bring the fattened calf and kill it and let us eat and celebrate, for my son was dead, but is alive again. He's lost and is found, and they began to celebrate. And then the older son got pissy about it and said, I always did everything right. Why are you being nice to him? And the dad said, well, he was lost, but now he's found. Okay, so that's the story. So here are the lessons that you can extrapolate to know how to recover from a mistake. Step one is don't screw up in the first place, but you're going to screw up. These are mistakes. Hopefully you make small mistakes. But if you make a mistake, no matter what size the mistake, step one, it says on verse 17, he was longing to be eating the pig food, and then he came to himself, which means he woke up. He had an aha moment. He became aware of his folly. He understood that, oh shit, I was an idiot. Step one is to be aware that you messed up if you mess up. So just knowing that you messed up. A lot of people stay in arrogance and ignorance, and they persist in their stupid. Step two, he didn't say to himself, I'm the son of the king. His dad was an important man. I'm the shit. I'm going to go back home and resume life as normal. I'm going to demand my place in the family. No, he didn't do that. Step two is humble yourself. So if you mess up, own it. Get into humility. Very, very important. People will bring you in for humility. If you're in arrogance, that's a way to separate yourself from friends, from family, from coworkers. Don't be arrogant. Get into humility quickly. So he owned it. And step two, he says, what did he say? He came from a good family, but he said to himself, I will arise, go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. So when he comes home and he says this to the father accepts the son back in. So if you enter into humility, it's easy to be restored to your position, whether that be at work, in a marriage, in different life contexts. Humility is always your friend. Stupidity. The best thing to do with a mistake is quickly own it. Own it for yourself. Don't point at other people. Don't look around and say, whose fault is it? If you mess up, it's your fault, period. So own that shit quick. Interesting, the response to humility is he was given a robe and a ring. And so that's a symbol of honor. That's also a symbol of authority. So restorative processes can typically happen on the backside of humility. Interesting, the other son in this story, which I think represents the church, the other son is a little bit jealous because he doesn't like the fact that he did everything right, and the asshole son came back and is being treated so well. The other son says, who was angry and he was refusing to go into the little party, said, look, these many years I've served you, I've never disobeyed your command, yet you never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. But with this son of yours came, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him. And the father said, son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. It was fitting to celebrate and be glad, for your brother was dead and is alive, was lost and is found. So again, allow me to recap. When you mess up, hopefully your mess ups are small and you have lots of mess ups, it means you're learning. When you mess up, all you have to do is own it quickly and get into humility. That's it. Own it and be humble. Let me give you a real life example from me. I was doing a install for UC Health, and I was in Denver, and I had to stay at a hotel in Highlands Ranch to open this hospital. And I was in a mood, and when I checked into the hotel, there was a guy in the front desk, and I forget what the issue was, but I don't know if he didn't serve me right or something like that, but I had an attitude with him. So I was just being honest. I was just rude as shit to the front guy desk at this Highlands Ranch, I think it was Holiday Inn Hotel. And then as I got on the elevator, I realized that I was out of line. That guy was just doing his job. So when I got up to my room, I picked up the phone and I called the guy and I said, "Hey, listen, I'm the guy you just talked to. Do you remember me?" And he said, "Yes." And I said, "Listen, I owe you an apology. I was in a mood, I was out of line, and I shouldn't have had that tone with you." And I just told him that. And I was pretty much the exact same exact words I used with him. "I was out of line. I used a tone with you that I should have. And I just wanted to call and say I'm sorry while I was thinking about it." Two things happened. One, he said, "Don't worry about it. I've dealt with people all week. I appreciate it." But all the rest of that day and the next day and the next day, when I went downstairs for breakfast, when anything was going on, he made sure that he waited on me first. He was kind to me. He addressed me by name. All the doors opened in terms of I got preferential treatment. And I wasn't apologetic to get preferential treatment. I was apologetic because I was out of line. And so when you mess up, I'm an adult. That was a great example from like a year or so ago where I was being kind of a dick. And so I was out of line. I owned it. I got into humility quick. I didn't wait. That was not an easy phone call for me to make, but I did it. It was the right thing to do. When you guys get into places in life where you make a mistake, do likewise. You'll go a lot much further. You'll have better quality relationships, and you won't usurp your own goals moving forward. So that's all I have for now. And yeah, I think that's all I have to say on that topic. Well, I suppose that's all I have for now. Got right to the point. Make your mistakes fast. This is your father speaking, the top T. Here in colorful Colorado, where youth meets opportunity and you yahoos will be indulging in my words from the butt crack of Florida, northern Florida, where old people go to die and middle-aged people hit the wall. That's all I have for now. Love you guys. You and I will talk again soon.